Engineering, I'm Alan. This week we start to make an indexing head. A few weeks ago I was talking to my brother and we were talking about how we could make an indexing head to fit on the Boxford, and he suggested we use a brake disc that fits on the back of the chuck. And the other day he came over to the workshop and bought me a brake disc. So today we're machining the brake disc to fit the back of a four-jaw chuck that fits onto the Boxford lathe. Now on my lathe, under where the chuck's mounted, there are two holes drilled into the headstock and tapped, and I've no idea what they're for. Obviously they could be for a machining process or something, but they're there on mine and on my brother's lathe. There may be for some attachment to fit on, so we're thinking we might be able to use these holes to fit a plunger on the outside of the chuck that locates in the brake disc bolted to the back of the chuck. Just one word of caution: when you're machining a brake disc, it's advisable to wear a dust mask, because the dust that's coming off that disc is partly rust but partly brake pad dust. Now in the old days, brake pads used to contain asbestos. The modern pads don't contain asbestos, or shouldn't contain asbestos, but the dust obviously is not good for your health if you're breathing brake pad dust into your lungs. So just use a mask if it's very dusty, or some sort of vacuum to take the dust away. So let's go to the workshop and see how we do it. This is a car brake disc. What I'm trying to do is separate the actual braking area from the hub, so I can use the hub as an indexing fixture. So by cutting a groove in here, I'm hoping it will come through the other side and free the outside of the disc. I've put the lathe in back gear and set the speed to 66 RPM. Is a thinner tool than that. Because of the diameter of this, it's rubbing on the bottom of the tool. The problem I have with this is I can't get any closer because of my saddle. It's right near the face of this disc, so that means my cut is being put on with the compound slide, and that's nearly at the end of its travel. I need to go about another 3mm deeper on here before this will detach, and the boring bar is sticking out a lot from the tool holder, causing vibration. That's why the finish is poor on the edge of the disc. I can see from the back here it's just coming through. So that means the cast iron is very thin on the lip. So what I'm going to do is take it off. The last thing I want is for this outside part to be falling all over the lathe. And if I look on here, you can see where it's shiny at the bottom there. That's where it's cut through. I should be able to tap that with a hammer. Now I've taken this off, I can get my saddle underneath the chuck. I've reset my boring bar. So first I'll take a skim over the face again. That's a better finish. And now I'm going to take a skim on the large face and the inside
to remove the rust and dirt. You may need to wear a dust mask when doing this part. That's cleaned most of the rust off. I'll just put a chamfer on this edge. Let's take the sharp edge off. You can see that down here I've just held a piece of rag over the lead screw just to stop the cast iron swarf getting onto the lead screw. It seems to have worked okay. I'll just replace that back here. Now I'll take it off the chuck, turn it round, locate off the face I've just machined and finish the outside. So that was the brake disc. We remove this part we don't need, and I've machined the front, the top, so they're running through, the inside, and just cleared the edge here just to remove the rust and dirt that was all on here. So the only thing I haven't touched is the bore, which is as it was originally. Now that should just fit my four-jaw chuck. What we're doing is making this to fit on the back of the four-jaw chuck. The bolt stuck out too far and I had some nuts that was originally on it, so I just put the nuts back on. These nuts are not doing anything, the holes are threaded, so I can now take these nuts off so we can put holes around the outside of this to give us an indexing plate. I've clamped the disc to the centre of the table and set the tool to the centre of the bore. Now I've changed to a Jacob's chuck because this countersink has a hexagon on. It's important that I control the depth of the countersink, so I've pushed the countersink so it's touching the end of the jaw so it's not going to slide up, and now when I start the countersink I know exactly where that countersink is. Change the speed to the slowest. The screw I have is a 6mm K countersunk screw with the hexagon in, and I just want to make sure that that just goes into there flush with the surface. That's okay, that just sits into the hole. The two holes. Okay, I fitted my four-jaw chuck onto the table and I've just clamped it down using the back of the jaws to hold it down. I've used some wooden blocks to give me the height for the clamps, and all I want to do is drill two center holes, drill it out to 5mm and tap it to M6. Looks okay. Position to the next hole. Center drill back in. And it fits.
Well, that's fitted okay to the back of the four-jaw chuck.
The four studs that I left that hold the chuck on fit into the holes that originally had the wheel studs when it was on a vehicle. So I've only had to drill two holes, countersink them, tap the back of the chuck, and that holds the disc in place. Now, it doesn't need to be held on with great force, because all it's going to do is be an indexing disc. So the next job was to drill holes around the outer rim at the intervals that we want, and it's wide enough to do two or three sets on this. Well, that's it for today. Hope that was interesting, hope you enjoyed it, and we'll see you next week on Enots Engineering.